Father, we thank you for the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Father, we thank you for the fire of your glory in the midst of your church. Father, we thank you that you, by your own power and your might, begin to work a work in our day that no man would believe. Though they saw it with their eyes and heard it with their ears, everything of religion burned up, everything belonging to a realm called darkness eliminated. Father, we thank you for this great outpouring of the Holy Spirit here in this nation. Father, we thank you for a great outpouring of your presence and your glory, oh God, right here in this city. Father, right here in this church, right here upon the lives of everyone standing here right now. In the name of Jesus. In the name of the living God. Father, we thank you for your fire, the fire of your presence. Father, we thank you for the fire, your holy fire. Lord, we thank you for your glory, the glory of your presence. Lord, we thank you for your glory, your holy glory. Lord, we thank you for your spirit, your glorious Holy Spirit. Lord, we thank you for your spirit and your power. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, write down the name of Jesus. If you have sickness or pain in your body, be healed. Anyone who has sickness or pain in your body, I want everybody's hands down. Anybody has sickness and pain in your body, I want you to lift your hands up, both of them. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I command you to be healed right now. Pain, obey me and go out of the body now. Out! Now. Now, as the pain departs out of your body, you can begin to lift. You can set your hand. You can put your hands down. As the pain goes out of your body, you can put your hands down. Now, in Jesus' name, pain evacuate. Pain go. All of it. There you go. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, living God. John, come here. Yeah, John, come here. Have any pain in your body? Huh? So come tell everybody. Look. It's just really, really, really simple. John come walking up here, and he says he earlier, just before the meeting began, he just walked up, and he it felt like he was interrupting me because he was up here working. I just said, look, be healed right now. The beautiful thing of it is, doesn't matter what's going on, as soon as you begin to cooperate with the Lord Jesus Christ, the anointing will manifest, and the power of God will be available for anyone who can receive. I'm going to talk to you about that tonight. John, tell him. You tell him, man.
I just want to say, when I was coming into the sanctuary, I just knew I was going to get healed.
That's a big part of it right there.
It's amazing, and I knew it. I knew it was going to happen, and it happened. And
praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's the one thing you and I have in common. When I came into the meeting tonight, I knew the power and the glory of Almighty God would be present, because everywhere I go, Jesus goes with me. It's a promise that he gave to anybody who would believe.
Somebody said, do you think you're special? Yes, absolutely. I've been redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit has come upon me and made me a new creature and given me the power and the authority to be called a son of God. Yes, that's very special. I've been made one with Christ Jesus. God the Father lives in Christ Jesus, and Christ Jesus lives in me. I've been made the temple of the Holy Ghost. He walks around on the inside of me, sees through my eyes, talks through my mouth, handles through my hands, walks out his purposes in my feet. Hallelujah. And I have come to agree with him concerning his purpose and his desire for humanity, that all men everywhere might be saved. And all Father's looking for is somebody like praying John Hyde, who had no longer lived for themselves, but lived rather for the kingdom of God, step out of this life and slip over into the realms of the heavenly. Hallelujah. Somebody like Father Nash that traveled around with Charles Finney praying and interceding. A man of God who pastored for many years, and when he was 40, I believe it was 44 years old. No, it was 42. He had built a church in upstate New York and gave his life to it. And then the congregation, after he got it built up, the congregation decided they wanted a younger man. So he quietly left and slipped into a closet of prayer and found a realm of divine power and glory that shook this nation a little over 100 years ago. Shook this nation. Hallelujah. Charles Finney, before he would go anywhere, he'd send Father Nash ahead of him. And he'd walk around the city or the town or wherever it was that they were at. He'd kind of just take in the sights and see what was going on. Then he'd go into a place of just fasting and praying for 2-3 weeks, however long he felt. And then when he was done, he'd say, okay, now come on. Hallelujah. And then when Charles Finney would step out into the platform or out into the venue, begin to minister the word of Jesus Christ, power and glory of God fell. Hallelujah. You may not realize this, but what is going on in this place, what I am doing very purposefully, is I'm laying hold on a realm of God's grace that he has made available for anybody who's passionate about it. Religion wants you to accommodate whatever it thinks. Men want you to accommodate whatever they believe, but the Holy Spirit has a direction. The Word of God has an insight. Men can live after their own opinions and after their own ideas, but there's only one Word which lasts forever, and that Word gives to us the wisdom of God. The wisdom of God is knowing what God is doing and doing it with them. And there's no question about it. There's nobody going to labor in vain in that realm. There's nobody going to be disappointed. God's going to be faithful to his promises. As much as he is a God of love, as much as he's a God of tender mercies, he's a God of faithfulness. As much as he's a holy God, pure God, faithful God, he's watching over his word to perform it. His word's been... His word was incarnated into flesh 2,000 years ago, and his word's been born in our heart. We've received an incorruptible seed, hallelujah, by the word of God which lives and abides forever. We've been made a new creation by this incorruptible seed. Blessed is the name of the Lord. Your fire falls. Sing it, baby. Your fire falls. You fire fall on us. Let your fire fall. Your fire fall. Let your fire fall on us. Let your fire fall. Let your fire fall.
Let your fire fall. Let your fire fall. Yes, Lord.
There's no one like you, Lord. There's no one like you, Jesus. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Let Father take control of your life. Lift your hands towards heaven and surrender all to Jesus Christ. Lift your hands towards heaven. Let the blood that cleanses wash you white as snow. Lift your hands towards heaven. Let the Holy Ghost and fire baptize you so that His glory will overwhelm you and flow out of you in Jesus' name. In the name of the living God. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Father, I thank you that everything about the lives of these people that stand here in this place tonight change. They go from glory to glory by the Holy Spirit as we yield to you. Father, I thank you tonight that the doubt and the unbelief and the uncertainty and the distractions and the events of life that have discouraged and disappointed and even caused despair, that they become without meaning, without effect in every person's life. Father, we thank you that you come upon us and you begin to burn in our lives with your presence so that nothing else about our life even looks like earth. Everything about our life looks like you. Everything about our heart's desires are those desires which belong to you. Father, I pray now in the name of Jesus. Father, I ask you tonight that by your Spirit, wisdom and revelation will fill the hearts of every person in this place so that there is absolutely no way that they can consciously live their lives the same or behave the same or interact the same with you and with others around them. Father, I pray that every person here will realize and understand and see the call. In Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. You can be seated. Hallelujah. Well, let me just start off by saying we're very happy to have all of you here. We know that Christ Jesus, we know that He is who He says He is, and that the Word of God is an accurate description of what God is doing. We are one, I am one, of many hundreds of thousands, and you could even say tens of millions, alive today that are proof that what Jesus Christ said is an absolute certainty. That the works, the signs, the wonders, the miracles, the kind of life that He has given for us to live is a possibility. That you need no longer have any demonic activity in your life. That you need no longer have pain and torment and suffering. You need no longer walk in a realm with demon spirits. But now you can come over and step into the glorious light of Christ Jesus, the glorious life of God, and begin to live out every day communing with angels and fellowshipping with God. I'm telling you, it's a far better life. It's an abundant life. It's a life of glory. It's a life of joy unspeakable and full of glory. It's a life of peace that passes understanding. It is a life that is filled with the love of Christ that passes knowledge. It's available for you. Father has a lot better life for you to live than the one you've been living. An earthly one isn't good enough. No, an earthly one would really, by definition of God, is like one who's dead and not alive. He that has Christ Jesus and received this heavenly life by the Holy Ghost, who's received this heavenly life because they've called upon the name of Jesus, the only means by which men can be saved. Somebody says, why is Jesus the only means by which men can be saved? Because He's God come down into flesh. He showed us He is the light of life. He is the very description of everything that is opposite of all that is going on in this world. And he came for the single purpose of taking the sins of every man upon himself, putting that sin to death and destroying him. Satan's power that he held over mankind, so that you and I could now step over into a relationship with Father and begin to take up walking with him in the garden where Adam left off just before he rebelled. You decide what your communion is going to be. You know, when we read in Ephesians chapter 6, we discover that we are literally in a wrestling match against spiritual wickedness. The Lord tells us that in verse 10 of chapter 6, you can open up your Bibles. I'm going to talk to you about things that are going on in your life that you have no knowledge of. I'm going to shine the light on that thing. And if you want it broken off your life tonight, you can walk out of here clean, demon-free. You can walk out of here tonight pain-free. You can walk out of here tonight understanding the victory that overcomes the world. The power that is in the name of Christ Jesus. It's all up to you. You choose whatever you want. The one reality of it is God's made one way of escape so that you don't have to live a life of sin. I don't care what you believe. It doesn't matter what people have told you. If you've never understood how to live free from sin, how to live with authority and power over sin, you've never stepped into a revelation concerning this life that is in Christ Jesus, this life that has come to set us free from every influence of the powers of darkness that came upon mankind because of Adam's transgression and rebellion. And so we look here in Ephesians chapter 6, and Paul says, finally, brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. And that's certainly a whole lot of strength. Jesus said in Luke chapter 10 and verse 19, just after he had told the disciples that he saw Satan cast down out of heaven and fell to the ground when Lucifer tried to ascend to the throne of God, tried to overthrow God, tried to lead an open rebellion against him, who by his craft and deceit went and led angels by the who knows how many, thousands and tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions, who knows what that number is, 10 million, 100 million, billions, trillions, we have no idea. I mean, we get this little hint of a revelation in Revelation chapter 12 that he drew one third of the stars, which is a symbolism of the angels. We know that he has a great host and company, and by his craft and the seed, he was able to turn the heart of mighty angels, cherub angels, great and mighty authorities in God away from allegiance to the Father to come follow him. What do you think he's going to do to you? Christ Jesus is... Man has no ability within the framework of his human effort to stand against the smallest force of satanic power. Be certain of this. Satan goes around as a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. And the only way he can be resisted is steadfast in the faith. Understand this. There is a lot of tricks and seduction going on. For these are the last days. And the word of God reveals to us in the last days there would be seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. And the masses would be led away. Christ Jesus said, broad is the way that leads to destruction, and many's walking on that path. He said, very narrow is the way into the realms of the kingdom, and narrow is the path, and few there be that find it. Even though all the glory of heaven, all the power of the living God is shining upon that path, very few people are willing to surrender all to a life that we have now freely been given in these riches which Christ has poured out upon us. Now you look here and you can see that he tells us to put on the whole armor of God that we may be able to stand against the tricks of the devil. Who also, if you look in Revelation chapter 12, the devil is called Satan. And we do not know his name, we just know his deeds. He's the devil because he is an accuser. He's Satan because he is a slanderer. This is what he does. His accusation and his slander is first against God. That's all he's doing is slandering and accusing God. And what happens in the world of the angels of darkness, the worlds of darkness that now governs this world that we now live in. Paul refers to it in Ephesians chapter 2, and he said that we were once under the authority of the God of this world, the prince and the power of the very atmosphere, the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience. His effect and his power upon people is such that out of his influence, men speak. CNN broadcasts. Fox News declares what it is they are going to do. Presidents issue forth their edicts. Kings and prime ministers make their decisions in that realm. And so with this parallel that we see here in verse 12, where God says, you wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. That's verse 12. It has a parallel structure for which it works its works out through mankind who have given themselves over to live in that realm, who've rejected the knowledge of the truth. They've rejected Christ Jesus. Many of them go to church. Many of them attend religious services. Many of them say they know God. They say they're on the way to heaven, but their deeds and their fruits deny him. If there's anything that's got to happen within the context of revival in the Church of the United States of America, it's this. Holy Ghost conviction has got to come to the hearts of God's people on an individual basis, where that Holy Ghost conviction now rules over us and governs us with the ways and the purposes and the will of the Father, so we're not involved with the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. It is through those three things that Satan works his craft. It's through those three things that he will destroy your soul. It's those three things that he tried to overthrow Jesus when Jesus went up and was tempted of the devil 40 days in the wilderness. It was out of those three things that he was able to overthrow Adam in the beginning. Those tricks didn't work against Jesus because he had given himself over and completely resigned himself to live according to the will of the Father, to live in a heavenly realm. Well, when you think about Satan is coming at us with tricks and all kinds of devices, when we think about that we are wrestling, I mean, there could not have been a more descriptive word to use of up close grappling, up close confrontation, hand to hand and foot to foot, than to use the word wrestling, especially within the context of the culture and the time and the day in which the Apostle Paul lived, because it was something that was very common in the arena at Ephesus. And he looked at the wrestling arena at Ephesus where the conflict was going on and men were trying to be champions in the realm of wrestling and overcome one another. And he said, you see that? That's what's going on right now between God's people, the saint, the individual saint, and all the powers of darkness. The good news is that Paul opens up Ephesians in Ephesians 1:3 and says we're blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly. And reality of it is he's talking about spiritual gifting, power, and authority. As Jesus said in Luke chapter 10:19, I give you authority to tread upon scorpions and serpents and over all the power of the enemy. I have authority over every work of Satan. He must obey me. He hates the thought of it, so he's going to try to neutralize me. He's going to try to steal my rights with God, my ability to stop what it is he's doing, my ability to commune with the Holy Ghost, and the weapons that he uses and the tricks that he uses is the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life. Dear people, you go through much torment, suffering, and pain, and harassment, all because you gave in to a lying demon spirit doing the will of an angel of darkness. Yes. Forfeiting a great opportunity to grow and mature, to walk with the Lord and rather have angels come and minister to you, just as it was with Jesus in the garden, or rather in the wilderness. You can read it as Jesus was tempted in the wilderness that after that he was tempted, the angels came and ministered to him. I guarantee you, God wants to come and strengthen you. He wants to come and speak peace to you. He wants to come and speak faith to you. He wants to come and speak confidence and boldness. He wants to come and strengthen you. He wants to bless you. He wants to cause you to inherit all things. He wants you to be filled up with everything that belongs to His character and way, His loving kindness, His tender mercies, His goodness. But you have to make a decision. It's time you quit being taken out. It's quite time that you quit being so blind, so undiscerning, so lacking in the department of the word of knowledge and the word of wisdom and the discerning of spirits. I tell you right now, that must work effectively first for you to shut down the voice of darkness, to shut down the lies of Satan, because he's doing a very good job at neutralizing most of God's people and making them powerless and ineffective against all of his tricks and all of his wiles and all the crazy things that he's doing. When you can bring down and distill down into your daily decisions how you're going to walk with God, suddenly you begin to walk in wisdom. Suddenly your eyes are open. Suddenly you have a discernment. Suddenly you have an insight. All of a sudden you discover how sensitive your heart becomes to the will of the Father. But the more sin you allow in your heart, the more things that you give yourself to in terms of interacting with demon spirits, the less you're able to hear the voice of the living God or respond to anything that He's doing. It becomes absent, distant from you. You become numb and dull to any activity of the Holy Ghost. Trapped in a place of despair. Trapped in a place of discouragement. Trapped in a place of blindness of heart and blindness of mind. A preacher like me comes along, and I'm nothing more than an object of hate and despite. Why? Because I'm going to get in the face of the demon spirit that is influencing men to feel and think the way they do. And they're either going to repent, fall down before the presence of the Lord and be delivered, or everything that demon feels is going to be influencing that person, and the outworking of it is going to be manifested. And thus we see a church that is torn in pieces with strife and division and a repulsion towards the ministers of the Lord Jesus Christ, who preaches the reality of a changed life, a transformed life, no more sin. There has to be a place, a line drawn in your life. If there's not a line drawn in your life, you're going to fall out to his propaganda. That's the way Satan works. He starts off with propaganda. You can look back in Ezekiel chapter 28, beginning in verse 12, and you can see how he led away the angels with his propaganda. Yeah. And you could see then, you could see a little bit of influence there in Isaiah chapter 14, beginning right there at about verse 10. Once again, his propaganda. You can see that his very name means slanderer. Once again, he's propagating a lie against the truth. He's just as he was saying to Eve, "You shall not surely die if you disobey God." And that works very effectively today. The truth of the Lord Jesus Christ is that with the heart, man believes into righteousness. That is cornerstone to the salvation of the gospel that is there revealed on the Romans Road, which we have all, cross denominations, looked at as a very cornerstone of the gospel. With the heart, man believes into righteousness. But look at the deceiving spirits and doctrines of devils today that have overthrown men and taken away their ability to resist him by convincing them that man believes in their heart unto unrighteousness. Saying, "Oh, we're all unrighteous. Oh, we're all sinners." Twisting what Paul said in Romans chapter 3, where he tried to make Jews and Gentiles on the same level. Twisting what God said by the psalmist in Psalms chapter 5, when he declared to the condition of Israel and their sin and their iniquity and hardness of heart, where they would not repent, and those things which were said also by the prophet Isaiah, under the same context. And having no application whatsoever to the church of the Lord Jesus Christ, redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ, washed in the blood, born of the Spirit, and baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. Religion will lie to you as much as Satan will lie to you. In fact, he's always used religion. It's always been his tool to deceive men. Jesus makes it very clear. He says, not everyone who says, "Lord, Lord," will enter in. He said, those who do the will of my Father, those are it. Those who do the will of my Father. He's made known what the will of the Father is. He says, depart from ye, depart from me, ye that are worthless, or you that work iniquity, or you that live lawlessly. That's the same word, anomia, in Greek language. Dear people, it's time that you quit letting the influences and the voices that saturate the atmosphere have impact on you. And I'm going to tell you right now, you're going to have to understand that as much as you are weak if you do not eat breakfast and lunch and supper, you are going to be equally weak if you don't sit down and partake of this word of life. And I'm telling you, it's not a religion, because I see people religiously partaking of the word of life and it doesn't become profitable to them because it's not mixed with faith. They're just religious. I know Orthodox Jews who can quote every scripture on any given verb. Just give them a particular verb and give them a particular form of the verb and they'll tell you every scripture where it's found, but it's profited them nothing. Why? Because they've not been born again with a changed heart. Now having the very life of the Holy Ghost on the inside of them, having a heart to do these things, to walk in love, to walk in truth, to walk in goodness. People still hating one another and bickering. I'm telling you, I don't understand it. I have too much fear of God. I don't understand how people can do these things, how they can talk bad about one another, how they can point the finger of accusation against one another, how they can judge one another, how they can go and dabble and sin in iniquity. I live under a constant awareness of God's indignation and wrath against sin. Don't mistake what I'm saying. I'm very confident about His love for me. I'm very, very confident about how important I am to Him. I'm very confident about His presence with me and that He'll do anything I'll ask. But I am equally confident of how His judgment abides against sin and iniquity of every shape and type and form. And I have a trembling fear in my heart lest a promise left me of entering into His rest I should come short of it. I have the same fear in my heart that Paul the apostle had when he said, I subject my body, I keep it in line, lest I, after me, myself, having been a preacher of the gospel, should end up being a castaway, refused by God. Now, is that some kind of condemnation? No. It's good sense. It's to recognize that Father will never agree with iniquity. Christ Jesus got serious about it and He said, if your eye offends you, pluck it out. It's for better for you to enter into life having one eye than to go into hell with both eyes. And he made it very, very graphic. Hell fire that burns with brimstone forever. People think they can cheat on God and get away with it. There is nothing hid from Him with whom we have to do. And I'm telling you right now, you better prepare to meet your God. Because He is coming with 10,000s of His saints to execute judgment upon all the ungodly for all the ungodly deeds which they've ungodly committed. And it doesn't matter if they sit in the church every Sunday and even on Wednesday nights or not. God is no respecter of persons. He does not have a diverse weight and diverse measure. He will judge every man according to His word. He's made a way of escape for you and me. There's no temptation that come at us except for which God has given us the ability to withstand it. Made a way of escape. He's told us that we should find ourselves blessed having endured temptation, having not been overcome by it. He said, because a crown of life awaits for you, a crown of righteousness which shall not fade away. People, you need to get serious with your life. We recognize that if one died for all, as the Apostle Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, one died for all, then we are all dead. You are supposed to recognize that you are bought with a price and you have no more rights to live your life according to your own wants and wills and wishes. Rather, God in His great mercy has given us this wonderful exchange. His life for ours. He took all our sins and bore them in his own body on the tree, so that now we, being dead to sin, may live unto righteousness, by whose wound we were healed. Should I say it again? Do you know where the reference is? Is it in your heart? Do you believe it? We've got to understand, dear people, that there is a foul thing afoot. We've got to understand that we have an adversary, the devil. We have principalities and powers, wickedness, whose purpose is to turn all mankind against God. And if he cannot return man's heart in open acts of rebellion against God, then he'll do everything he can to at least separate them from the knowledge of the truth, so that he may master them and have domination over them and credit to his own name. And he uses it, even as he did in the book of Job. He came and accused God. In Job chapter 1 and Job chapter 2. He said, there's nobody who serves you. There's nobody who walks with you. They all walk with me. Father had one guy on the whole planet. One guy on the whole planet. One guy, I said, in the whole planet. Praise God for one guy on the whole planet. Job. He said, have you considered my perfect servant, Job, who's righteous in all of his ways? Now, there's none righteous. No, not one. Take that, put it in your pipe, and smoke that. Are you listening to me? Are you listening to me? And God's testimony. You considered my perfect servant Job, who's righteous in all of his ways. There was another man God called perfect in a similar situation, where the angels of darkness had so had their way with men that men, God said, it repents him. He repents that he even made man. The thoughts of his mind and heart are only wicked continually. We know that in the last days it's going to be like those days. We know that the prophet Isaiah said they have eyes full of adultery and they cannot cease from sin. Never has there been a time in the history of man that that verse of Scripture could be more accurately and perfectly fulfilled, with all of the pornography and all of the sin and wickedness that is there, wide open on the television, wide open on special programming, wide open on the internet, and people are continually consumed by a very specific act of an angel of darkness that is doing a work purposefully to destroy your soul in hell, to separate you from God and destroy you. Soul in hell. This is true. He is advancing his agenda more and more. There's no legislation, no Republican Party, no Tea Party, no any party can any do anything about the situation as it stands right now in this nation. There's only one power to subdue what Satan is doing, and it's somebody who's taking a hold of God that stands in the midst of his church. I know there's a lot of people, they go to church anywhere because they're all hypocrites. I heard one guy say, my goodness gracious, not going to church because they're all hypocrites, say, like saying you're not going to go to the gym because they're all out of shape. Reality of it is, the church of the Lord Jesus Christ is alive and well. And you don't go to church because Satan's having his way with you. As you sit there all pious and self-righteous. If you had a bit of Jesus in you, you'd go lay down your life for that foul thing you are upset about. If you had a little bit of love of Jesus Christ in your heart, you'd go lay down your life for the church of the Lord Jesus Christ and pray and intercede like praying John Hyde did. He brought a whole Hindu nation. He began to influence a whole Hindu nation and begin to see it fall to its knees. What could you do in your local church up there in Montana or wherever you at that are listening to me on the web right now or watching this on a YouTube? And, of course, I'm speaking into YouTube. This first for you. You came in here to this place tonight. God's jealous over you. He loves you. He's made a way where Satan and the powers of darkness and demon influence has no right to touch you. This is true. See, John knew something that we didn't know, and he wrote in 1 John 5:18, he says, we know. They knew. We don't. They knew. So we have to say it like this. They knew that whoever was born of God did not sin, but kept themselves, and the wicked one could not touch them. I know it too. I'm one of the voices. It is amazing to me One of the first epistles that I ever memorized as a whole epistle was 1 John. And it was amazing to me how Satan's craft is so effective against God's people that they could actually go to 1 John 1, 8 and 10 and try to find a reason to accommodate sin out of the most radical epistle that says you cannot have sin in your life and be right with God. The most radical epistle in all of the Bible, excluding none. Not understanding very clearly that you could not convince, and even to this day, an Orthodox Jew, or who we call the Haredim, that they are sinful, or that they have sinned, for they are righteous. You can't convince a Jew, an Orthodox Jew, that he's got sin, and you can't convince a Christian that he's righteous. It is one big crazy game. One big crazy game. And so long as you're going to sin more or less or every day, you can't be strong in the Lord and strength of his might. You can't. Because you're going to sin more or less every day. What are you going to battle? Say, what are you going to battle against Satan about? Huh? How is the weapons of your warfare going to be mighty? When you are under his power, you're under his reign, you're under his domination. Paul said in Romans chapter 5, verses 12 through 21. He laid out a case that what Adam did and the transgression of Adam and the disobedience and the sin and the death that followed could not hold a candle to what Jesus did for us, that what Christ Jesus did through us through his obedience, this life that he has brought to us and this grace that now reigns is far greater in effect upon us than the effect of Adam's transgression. Yet who believes our report, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? And I'm telling you, when Isaiah said that, he was talking about Jesus, because he talked about a tender root growing up out of a dry ground, referring to the coming of the Messiah, Christ Jesus, the light that lighteth every man that comes in this world. He's the light of life. God has made you and I the light of the world, because the very life of God, like it was seen on Jesus and in Jesus as God incarnate, has now come into our lives, and we have the Son, Christ Jesus, and he who has the Son has this life. And we would just want to kind of qualify it as eternal life and act like it's something, you know, but that it's just a religious notion and theory and idea. Eternal life is the life of God. Eternal life is unlimited life. It is the life of the Spirit. It is the life of Jesus. It's an immeasurable life. It's a life that lasts forever. It is a quality of life as much as it is a quantity of life. People talk about the quantity, the long period of time. I tell you, you must know the quality of it. He that the Son sets free is free indeed. That's what Jesus said. That's what Paul said. Paul said in Romans chapter 6, he said, we were once the slaves of sin, but now we are the slaves of righteousness. And now being the slaves of God, we have our fruit unto holiness and the end thereof everlasting life. Hallelujah. And be certain that the next verse, that was 6:22, and the next verse, 23, is absolutely certain that the wages of sin is death, and it hasn't changed. And the gift of God is life forever. The life of Jesus, the life of the Holy Ghost. Don't just, you know, I watch and hear all the time as people misunderstand, both in the Hebrew language and in the Greek language, that message of a life forever, ageless life. Because they always attach to it the quantity of time, forgetting and forsaking an equally important description of that life. Quality of it. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness. Jesus said, the Father said when he revealed himself to Moses, he said, this is who I am. He says, I am merciful, gracious, long-suffering, full of goodness and full of truth. That's who he is. That's who Papa is. And now he's transferred his life into us when the blood of Jesus poured out of his veins. His life fluids flowed out of him at the cross, fulfilling the will of God, being our Lamb, destroying sin in his own body, putting to death the power of Satan at the cross. He, through death, destroyed him that had the power of death. That is the devil. Hebrews 2:14. I believe that. I believe that God has taken me And according to what Paul said in Colossians chapter 1 and verse 13, he translated me out of this kingdom of darkness, out of this place where Satan now dominates the hearts of men and rules viciously. He's translated me into the kingdom of the dear Son. Has anybody else read that besides me? Has anyone else believed it? Who has believed our report? That we have been transferred over into a area, translated over into a area called heaven. You would think you're misinformed if you think it's a planet somewhere out there in another solar system. God doesn't need a planet in another solar system. Heaven is a realm where the Holy Ghost is. Heaven is a realm where Christ Jesus exists, where God the Father exists. That's the heavenly realm. That's the heavenly realm that Paul is referring to in Ephesians 1:3. When he says, we're raised up together with him and seated together with him in the heavenly realm, there's no sickness there. Get over your sickness. But you can't, so long as you can't get over your sin, because they are Siamese twins joined at the hip. Wherever one goes, the other goes. And then how many heads do they have? But it's monstrous. Yes. It's just like Jesus said, should this woman whom Satan has bound and afflicted these 18 years not be set free on the Sabbath day? Dear people, understand that the Lord Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil. That's what he came for. You know that? He came to destroy the works of the devil. Has he come to you? I'm going to ask you, has Jesus come into your heart? Has Jesus come into your life? Has Jesus come into the existence and the place in which you live and dwell and think, and the place that you desire and want? You must understand, nothing that goes into the mouth like food that is eaten with unwashing hands or unkosher food can contaminate your spirit. It's only those things that go into your heart that can make you unclean. Things that would go into your heart that belong to a world outside where the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life reigns, a place where Satan now is the prince and the power of the air, where he is the god of this world, where he is the active agent, the active spirit at work in the style, in what's modern, what's fashionable, what everybody's excited about going seeing. If somebody tells you, you need to go see it, it's amazing. If a bunch of people in the world tell you, you need to go see it, it's amazing. All they're doing is being witnesses of Satan's next propaganda and lie and infiltration in subtle ways that you cannot even imagine nor discern. You get over here and you start walking with him in the light as he's in the light. Get over here. Ha! Start walking over here in the presence of the living God like he's in the presence of the living. And those powers of darkness that have influenced you subtly work at you with their propaganda and suddenly overwhelm you with their influence and their desire will be made manifest. And you won't fall prey to their works and their craft. It's about time somewhere that the church of the Lord Jesus Christ stand up, the holy company of God's people. Understand that the Lord wrote in the epistles 43 times to the saints. He wrote to the saints. So when we talk about saints, either in the Hebrew language or in the Greek language, it literally means holy ones. He did not write to the unholy ones. That's Antichrist. That's Antichrist. That's demonic. Somebody says, oh, you're not of the right spirit. Oh, I'm not of the right spirit because I'm telling you to fully walk with God and live a sanctified, consecrated life and have no powers of darkness influencing you at all. That's nonsense. I stand on the high ground, the mountain of his word. There's no way Satan can throw me off this place. There's no way he can invalidate what I'm saying. When the Word of God is the judgment, when the Word of God is the balance and the authority. Yeah? It's true. Listen to me. God's called us out of darkness into his marvelous light. He's called us to come walk in the light as Christ Jesus is in the light. He's called us to come over here and live in a place where we're protected, where the angels of God encamp around about us, where the power and the fire of God is upon us, and no power of darkness can access us. Think about it. Satan trying to argue with God, arguer. I like arguers. I don't argue. I see arguing as strife. I have nothing to do with it. I walk in the light. I'm very sensitive to demonic activity. I'm very sensitive to it. I deal with it ferociously. First in my own life, and secondly anywhere else I see it. In the unbeliever, absolutely, Satan, you go now in Jesus' name, whether it's manifested in sin, sickness, or disease. And especially in the believer in the house of God, I make myself a whip should the Lord so stir me. You know, and drive it out. You with me? You with me? Understand? Well, Satan is an arguer. And he said, well, Job's only serving you because you put a hedge about him. Well, God did put a hedge about him. His protection. But God done something a whole lot better for us than what he did for Job. Well, if a hedge can prevent Satan from being able to touch Job so that Job could be a perfect man and walk up right in every way, or be righteous in every way, think about what he's done for you and me. He's baptized us in his presence and in his fire. He's filled our hearts with his own desire. Satan comes along and he casts his desires upon us, and with his deceptive trick makes us to believe that it's our desire, that we want that lust, that we want that evil, that we want that pride, that we want that iniquity. No, it's an illusion. God's word that reveals the truth has described to us that he's written his laws upon the tables of our hearts, his ways, he's inscribed them in us. His Holy Spirit, he that is joined unto the Lord is one spirit. Therefore, what the Holy Ghost wants is what I want. I got a new heart. That means new desire. Out of my belly, kolia, passions and emotions flows. Inexhaustible expressions of the Holy Spirit. That's what Jesus said. He said, if you drink this life I have for you, it'll be life, the full life of God in you, more than you can tame, and it'll flow out of you like rivers, unexpressible rivers of the Holy Ghost. Every foul spirit of hell, every principality and power of wickedness that has ruled in this place called San Diego, this region called Southern California, I defy you, I bind you, I destroy your work in Jesus' name. And I know that's effective. And I've been doing it for a little over 30 years. And I know exactly what I'm doing. And I know exactly where we're going, because there's going to be somebody in every place. God got somebody who's standing shouting to the mountain, grace, grace, grace. Who's speaking to the mountain of ignorance, be removed and cast into the sea. Hallelujah. I was thinking today how God connects things, you know, and we were looking back, just kind of thinking about the history, and a little over 30 years ago, my wife and I met really at Calvary Chapel North Park. I was doing college Bible study, Calvary Chapel North Park, which is now Horizon, and they bought this place, and now we're trying to buy it from them. You know, this it's just, you know, God has a way of putting things together and connecting things and doing things. And we think it's going to happen so quick, and it's going to happen this way or that way, and it has this fashion or that fashion. No, just stand here in this place with your arms lifted high, expecting Jesus to appear in the eastern sky. He's about to descend with the voice of a trumpet and the sound and the shout of an archangel. That's what I'm living for. I'm constantly looking for his appearing. Hallelujah. Come on now, people. Quit living a life that's consumed by this world, for Satan will use it as a tool and a weapon to deceive you and take you out. And ultimately, the Lord says that that light that is in you be darkness. How great is that darkness? And he really was speaking to people who believed that they were right and believed they had a relationship with the Lord, but they had not been set free from the powers of darkness. Jesus said, if you follow me, you will not walk in darkness, but you shall have the light of life. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I love being over here, walking around in spiritual authority with spiritual blessings. I have all spiritual blessings, all spiritual giftings in the heavenly realm, so that I have all authority over against all the powers of darkness to overthrow them. Christ Jesus came into my life and destroyed the works of darkness. Once again, people, this is the message of salvation. He creates a new heart and a new spirit. And he puts his Holy Spirit on the inside of us. I'm going to tell you right now, if you've been born of God, you do not have the same spirit that you were born with, whatever your birthday is. I was born on February the 5th, 1959. I was born to two Holy Ghost people who are descendants of long lines of preachers. And I was born with a spirit that is not acceptable to God, that cannot enter into the kingdom of God. And I was given, the day that I was born again, born of the Spirit, another spirit than the one that I received from my daddy, who was a Holy Ghost revivalist, and my mama, who was a Holy Ghost woman, whose grandfather was a great Holy Ghost preacher in the state of Tennessee. A great man of God in the 1920s. Still, I needed a new spirit. I got this new spirit. Satan wants to try to deceive God's people and convince them that his desires are their desires, and that is the trick, and that is the craft, and that is the power, that you and I have got to have enough insight and revelation and strength and power to be able to withstand. And so he arrays us with such glory and authority as an undefeatable minister of light and righteousness. That's the whole armor of God. It's his armor, not somebody else's armor. It's not some Roman clad. It's God's glorious mantle of his anointing and of his power and of his life. An undefeatable, invincible spirit of the living God, righteous man. Yeah. Now, Satan doesn't really have a whole lot he can do against that. Because the battle line is drawn. You know what side you're on. You know what side he's on. You know what weapons you have and what conduct and manner of life you're supposed to be living. You know what conduct and manner of life he expresses and dominates the hearts and minds of men with. I am at war. So are you, whether you recognize it or not. The sad thing is, when you're in the middle of a battleground and don't know it, you are just out for the count. You're out for the count. Hello. You're out. You're dead. I went out with the boys one day and went to a paintball, a place where they do paintball wars. And I got all cladded up. I got all set. And I've lived in the woods most of my life. I know how to hunt. I know how to survive in the woods. I figured, well, I got this. I've never done anything like this. I got this. I was taken out in the first 2 seconds, right between the eyes. I mean, I was just getting ready. And there were some people who really knew what they were doing. I mean, you know, those guys who have been trained in the military around here, they got it down. They spent, you know, days and days, months and months, years and years doing this thing. I just wanted to get everything all squared away, and I'm lifting up my head. Bang! I'm dead. No getting out of it. I'm splattered. My whole shield, the whole face shield, even if I wanted to go on, I'd have to stop for a while and clean up because I can't see nothing. I'm telling you, dear people, there is a war that you are engaged in. And you think that you have privileges to go and dabble with that which is satanic. Go and dabble in the camp of the wicked one. That is nuts. It's crazy. No idea. Praise God for his mercy. Praise God for his loving kindness. Praise God who's long-suffering towards us when we just don't get it. When we've called upon his name in an honest and sincere heart, we were drawn into his presence by the Holy Ghost, and then immediately we were surrounded by a bunch of religious people saying, don't worry about it. We're all in this world. We can't be too different, and don't be righteous about too many things. Is that nuts or what? Huh? Immediately, they spoil through the traditions of men and philosophies of men. Well, God's going to have revival. Pop's going to have revival. He's going to do it. If he can't do it here, he's going to do it in China. And China will cause, if he can't do it in China, and I believe he's doing it in China, he'll do it in some other Asian nation or Middle East nation or African nation. He'll do it and he'll provoke all the whole world to jealousy when we look and see some people who are walking in the divine power and glory, look like and act like Jesus Christ, who got a new spirit, a new heart, who live free from sin and walk in the authority of this divine power that has been given to us. Well, I'll tell you right now, I'll be right in the big middle of it. I'm in the number already. I paid a price to be in this number. But I mean, it's worthwhile price. I paid again and again and again. It's just the rejection of men, but it's the approval of God. No problem. Are you listening to me here tonight? It's just the privilege of knowing who I am and where I stand, and knowing that the power of God is greater than the power of Satan. That the power of righteousness is greater than the power of sin. That the power of love is greater than the power of evil. Hallelujah. Knowing that the power of the Holy Ghost is greater than any influence of any demon spirit. And that if I simply do what's right, and sometimes I know it's oppressed, sometimes we're overwhelmed when we're being persecuted and we're being hated and when people are laying out false judgments and misbehaving and then themselves not doing what's right. It's kind of a little bit intense sometimes to hold yourself over here in this long suffering and gentleness and mercy and love and forgiveness. But it's worth it. Huh? The vileness of porneo, which is what God uses as translated King James, the word whoremonger. His wrath is against all porneos. I'm not going there. How on earth can you even be that dull of senses? How can you be honestly that stupid? That blind? Come on now. That is just nothing but a demonic realm. You are doing nothing but participating with demon spirits. You are doing nothing but dancing to an angel of darkness string whose purpose to destroy you and will claim you until that thing is broken. He will claim you. And he'll just wait. Yeah, you saw you go to church and repent. Say, oh, Jesus, help me. Wash me in blood. And the Lord did. Because God's merciful. He just takes us at his word. He just takes us at our word. He's good. He's so full of love. He's like, in some ways, you know, a naive child. But he lets himself be that way because he just says, okay, I'll forgive you. As long as you're forgiving everybody around you, you keep the right attitude. You walk in humility. You know what humility is? The best way visual I can give you for humility is soft clay. You're moldable. You don't resist nothing. As long as you walk there. Now, people all haughty. People all rebellious. Don't listen to nothing, always arguing. Forget about it. You ain't getting nothing washed. You ain't getting nothing washed. You ain't even in the right heart and state. You haven't confronted enough of the reality of life to even ask in truth yet. Are you listening to me? It's true. It ain't just about some magical words that you speak, magical words, Jesus, and now magical words, now I'm magically saved. It's nonsense. The power of the Holy Ghost comes upon us and convicts us and reproves us. Huh? To where we fall down on our knees. He grants to us a gift, a very special gift. It's called by Paul in Acts chapter 11, the gift of repentance. Huh? The goodness of God leads us to repentance. I tell you, when you repent, that means you change and you walk in a different direction. I was once walking this way, being led by the course of this world, by the spirit that works in the children of disobedience. Now I'm walking this way in the light, as he is in the light, on this wonderful narrow highway, in the garden with him alone. Hallelujah. I mean, you know, listen, dear people, you need to understand the weapons of your warfare. You need to know how to be strong in the strength of the Lord. Listen. I'm talking about prayer that's not about prayer for some religious purpose, but it's prayer that gets touched. You know, the difference between religion and relationship, when a person has relationship with the Lord prays, the manifest presence of Jesus can be felt. As soon as I begin to pray, I feel the manifest presence of the living God. And you can tell by the way I'm praying. It's a fire in my belly. Shut up in my bones. It changes the atmosphere around me. Religion, it's just speaking into the air and nothing with it. There's nothing tangible with it. There's no glory. There's no presence of life. God's power and influence is greater than any other power and influence known to man. And yet we want to make him esoteric. We want to make this old thing, you know, existential, something that doesn't even have a tangible reality in our life. Nonsense. God is real. Christ Jesus is here. He said, "Lo, I'm with you always, even unto the end of the world." He said he'll go everywhere with us, convincing and proving those around us that he's with us, because he would confirm his word with signs following. The Holy Ghost is here to demonstrate not only in us, but through us and around us. Hallelujah. Dear people, why forsake such a blessed grace and privilege of being able to walk the Holy Spirit? Just because you couldn't stand up against those voices of demon spirits? Come on. Forget about all of that stuff that belongs to the pride of life and self-interest. How people think about me and feel about me. How do people think and feel about Jesus in you? How do you think and feel about your representation of Christ Jesus? Oh, come on now. Let's get things right. Let's just understand. You don't have a desire. You don't have a desire for wickedness and sin. It's not in you, not if you've been born again. But Satan would try to cast you on it, cast it upon you. He would try to work his work of deceit and lie to you and convince you that you want it. But you just stand there and you begin to worship Jesus. And that temptation just goes, "Lord Jesus, I love you. I glorify your name, Lord." And that desire is going to completely go away because that demon just evacuated before he was annihilated. Hallelujah. To be strong in the strength of the Lord and power of his might. I think one of the wonderful things I love about prayer is because I love the clarity that the voice of God brings to me. I love hearing him speak to me. I spend time just praying in the Spirit. I spend time talking to him. When I talk to him, I give thanks and praise him. That's what Daniel did 3 times a day. He gave thanks and praised the Lord. That's what I do. That's why I give thanks and I praise him. I don't tell him about all the things he needs to be doing and reminding him all the lost souls. I give thanks and praise him for his mighty grace and his mighty power. I thank him for the breath that I can breathe. I thank him for the blood that has cleansed me. I thank him for the anointing of his presence, his goodness, his long-suffering. How many times he's forgiven me when I failed over and over and over again. He brought me to this place and made my way perfect before him. And makes my way perfect. Are you listening to me? Because I make it very clear, I am not perfect, but I want to be. And I don't want to be perfect for your account or my account. I want to be perfect for him. Amen. He said, "Walk before me and be perfect." He told that to Abraham. Now, he may have been mistaken, but I don't think so. According to theologians, he's done messed up. He's done preached the wrong gospel. You understand what I'm saying? Telling Abraham, "Walk before me and be perfect." He needs to go back to theology school. He needs to relearn theology. His catechism is basically faulty. No, it's not. Ha, ha, hallelujah. And then Jesus comes along and says, "Be perfect even as your Father in heaven is perfect." That's what he said. That's what he said. And I'm going with what he said. I don't care what Augustine said. If Augustine said something that agreed with what Jesus said, then fine. But I'm going with Jesus. Amen. I'm going with Paul. I don't care what Eusebius said or Origen said or any of those, Jerome said or anybody else that they want to call church fathers. They're not my father. And not my church father. Paul's my church father, if you want to have a father. Are you listening to me? Peter, James, everybody else got anything in the Bible. John, Jude, hallelujah. Praise God. How about you? And most importantly, God in heaven's my father. And he's the church father. Are you listening to me? Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. I'm to destroy this thing. I'm to destroy the lies of Satan. I'm going to come with the Spirit of the Lord, and I'm going to bust up the rocks with the hammer of the living God. Amen. That's what my parents named me. They named me Hammer. Amen. Prophet of the Lord came along, said that the child that's in your, that you carry, the hand of the Lord's already upon him, and they gave me a name. Amen. And Papa knows how to fulfill his will. Praise God. And I love being in the middle of it. Listen, you got to be, if you're going to be strong in the strength of the Lord, you're going to have to understand how to be filled with the Spirit. And that the scripture says, redeem the time, for the day is evil. Don't be unwise, but be wise, knowing what the will of the Father is. Be filled with the Spirit. Speaking to yourself in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Sing and make a melody in your heart. That's called praise and thanksgiving. Are you listening to me? And in the context of that, praying with all supplication in the Spirit, Paul said there in Ephesians chapter 6, I believe that'd be verse 18. And Jude said, build up yourself in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Keep yourself in the love of God. That's what I'm doing when I'm praying, right there. And then in the midst of that, Spirit of the Lord speaks to me. The Lord speaks to me. I have clarity. I have strength. I have direction. I have ability to know what to do, where to go. It won't take long, baby, you walk with God. And I'm telling you, the Lord will begin to do things that you can that are even unimaginable to you right now. If I'm about ready to face temptation, immediately gushing intercession of the Holy Ghost comes out of me with heavenly language. And I know what it is, because I've been walking this walk. I've been walking this walk for many years. As soon as my feet hit the ground in the morning, flows out. I've been walking. I gave myself to this. I heard Paul say, I speak in tongues more than y'all. And I said, well, he got it right. I'm going to follow him. You know, he grabbed a hold of this. I'm going to do what he's doing. Today. My wife's over here giving witness to 28 years of that. Hallelujah. My Father loves me. He blesses me. He gives me all things freely to enjoy. He'll take stuff away from the wicked and give it to me. Ha! Hallelujah. And you don't like that, you take it up with him. You think that's unethical, you just take it up with him. Amen. Hallelujah. Are you listening to me? Praise God. You better leave all judgment for that day, because you're more than likely wrong. Amen. The only judgment we're certain of is the judgment of his word. Everything else, you don't really know what went on. You don't really know what went on. And if the person's a man of God or a woman of God, they're not going to tell you. I'm not going to tell you. Let's give you bits and pieces. And usually it won't be in a self-serving way. I'm telling you. Listen to me. I'm telling you. Because the nature of God's very different than the nature of men. It's very different than the nature of demon spirits. You and I aren't supposed to be conformed to demon spirits. Our life is not supposed to be conformed to the image of demon spirits. Our life is to be conformed to the image of the Son. You and I were predestinated for this. Amen. Is it true? Who could tell me the verse of Scripture? Romans 8:29. Praise God. It needs to be in your heart. These words need to be in your heart. Can you imagine what happens when the Word of God is, you live by the Word of God? Jesus showed us that the spiritual life doesn't consist of meat, doesn't consist of bread. It consists of having the Word of God. If the Word of God is in you, thy word have I hid in my heart, that I will not sin against you. I write unto you, young men, because you're strong. The Word of God abides in you, and you've overcome the wicked one. Those that are born of God, his seed remaineth in them, and they cannot sin. That's a wild verse of Scripture, isn't it? Yeah. Get some commentary on 1 John 3:9. Everybody trembles. How can this be? How can this be? Ha! Then they want to run over to verse 8 of chapter 1. Don't understand what's being said. Come on now. Don't look for an excuse to be wrong. Look for a reason to be right. Let me say it again. Don't look for an excuse to be wrong. Look for a reason to be right.
Don't look for an inability to be overthrown. Look for the power to live victoriously for the Lord Jesus, right? To the overcomer. To the overcomer. To the overcomer, I will grant you to sit down with me in my throne as I sat down with my Father in his throne. To the overcomer, if you overcome as I overcame, you will be dressed in fine white linen, which is the righteousness of the saints, for you are worthy. To the overcomer, he writes, those who overcome, you shall be a pillar in my house, and you shall never go out ever again. These are the words of the Lord Jesus. Most important thing for us to grab. I got the fear of God in me, men. Fear of God that teaches me to hate evil and love righteousness. That's the proof of the new birth. That's the witness of the Holy Spirit. Watch a lot of people go to these meetings and fall out and start laughing hysterically. And really, many times I see the power of God. But what happens is they don't understand. They understand. They get up and try to go back and live the same way. They've been living. When God touched them with his presence, said, this is the glory I want you to live in. People get overwhelmed with the peace of God, fall out under the power, look like they're in a deep sleep. No, they've been touched with the power of heaven. Then go up, try to then get up and go live life like they've been living, carousing, walking it out with demon spirits. Come on now. Somebody needs to preach the word in the midst of all that. Somebody needs to preach the word of faith in the midst of all that. Huh? So there needs to be. That's why there needs to be diversities of ministries. Amen. I know that all the right people are watching this right now. I know all of you love me. I know how you say. I know what you think. Well, that's just Mark. That's the way he is. That's what God made real to him. Amen. It's true. It's what he made real to me. I hope he makes it real to you. Because there's a dividing line here. It's a plumb bob. There's a plumb bob. Jesus Christ, it's a plumb bob that shows us the dividing line, the place between that which is right and that which is wrong. Huh? He pinpoints it, right? A plumb bob puts the dot on it. It's not some big fuzzy area. Say, the word of his seed remains in me. Wow, come on, say that again. The word of his seed.
The word of his seed.
His seed remains in me. Man, if you're living by the Word of God, if you're walking in the Word of God will strengthen you. It will stir you up. It will be like a hot coal from off the altar of God, burning, burning in your belly. It'll be a word of faith and power and authority in your life. Yeah, and in that context, you're not going to sin. Do you understand me? Huh? But how about you go... How about you just go for the next however long you normally go without... Why don't you just do this? I did this one time in my life. Let me suggest this to you. One time in my life, I said, I will not eat a bite of food until I read 5 Psalms. I want to put Father first. I wanted to learn to live by the word of the Lord. So that the word of God would be stirred up on the inside of me. I don't want to just read for the sake of quantity. I want to read because I want to be touched by his word. I want to be convicted, convinced, stirred. I want to be encouraged. I want vision. I want purpose that only comes from the word. You understand what I'm saying? Man, you start reading the word of God, then all of a sudden it's like a fire on the inside of you. You're like equipped. You're like strengthened. Now I'm able to stand against the tricks of Satan. Now what if you don't eat? What if you don't eat in the natural? You weak. What if you don't eat in the spiritual? You weak. So why is it that people just leave Ephesians 6:10 to just make believe? Or I don't know what. Because many times we're looking at folks that from a true and real practical application of the scripture, they really don't have a clear vision. They don't have a real clear outworking of a practical application of how to be strong and the strength of the Lord and the power of his might. I know what happened to Samson. Spirit of the Lord came upon him, and the scripture says he was strengthened. Huh? David, Spirit of the Lord came upon him, and he was strengthened. Everybody I ever read in the Old Testament, power of God, Holy Ghost came upon them, they were strengthened. That's how I get strengthened. I'm going to let the power of God come upon me, I'm going to get strengthened. I'm going to be filled with the Spirit. Amen. Prayer must always result in being filled with the Spirit. You got to quit living your life for yourself. Because what Satan is doing is his purpose to destroy you, overthrow you. And if you don't wake up and begin to become aware of his devices, don't be ignorant. There's no reason for anyone to be ignorant of his devices. Here's what's going to happen. At best, you're going to be neutralized. Neutralized. Having no authority over him. Living in a continual cycle. Sin, repent, 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 sin, repent. And actually, it's like this. Sin, repent, sin, repent. This is the way forward. Okay? Sin, repent, sin, repent, sin, repent. It's backsliding. It's called perpetual backsliding. Perpetual backsliding. Sin, repent, sin, repent. Because what happens is Satan just lies in wait. Satan is ruthless. He's rebellious. You ever known somebody like totally violently rebellious, hates everybody, cares nothing for no one? Those are some ruthless folks. Satan is that far more than that. He's rebellious. He's ruthless. And listen, nothing God's got to say. Only authority, only power and divine authority stops him. That's it. He gets paralyzed by the anointing of the Holy Ghost. Amen. He's forced. He's forced to do. He's forced to evacuate. He's forced to shut down. Dear people, you're going to have to decide how serious you are with God. Satan's going to just lie in wait, just hang out. Wait till your vulnerable moment. Just leave him. I got him. Mine. I got my seal on. I'll come get him when they die too. I'm going to come drag him right into hell. Because he believes it. Satan believes it. Over a lot of people. And when you have discernment of spirits, when God's made you sensitive there to the realm of heaven because you walk in heaven, you know, when I'm around all this stuff that people seem to say that's Christian liberty, all things are expedient, but all things are not lawful. I hear that come out of preacher's mouth, and I'm appalled. Okay, all things are lawful. Then I can murder you. It's fine. Of course, I never would want to, or somebody else can murder you, and that's fine. Huh? So you can do anything you want. Adultery's fine. All things are lawful, right? Adultery. Huh? Witchcraft. Whatever you want to do. That's nonsense. It's not what Paul was saying. He's talking about kosher food. He's talking about what you eat. Yeah, you can eat ham. It may not be expedient for you to eat ham because the Jewish person over there may be gagging right now. You can eat goat offered to idols because an idol is nothing. But you've got to be careful because it may not be expedient because there may be another brother over there who just came out of idolatry and that used to be what he would do to serve that idol and worship that devil. And now his conscience being offended, being a weaker brother, is now brought into some kind of bondage or offense. Hello. All things are lawful, but not Satan. You a stinking liar! I bind you right now. I hate you with a perfect hatred. I come out against you in the name of Jesus, and your craft cannot work anymore among everybody that's listening to me right now. Amen. Amen. I pray you never believe that lie again. All things are lawful, but all things are not expedient. I had somebody sit in my living room not too long ago and tell me that. And I'm just looking at them going, you can't be serious. You can't be serious. Hello, this is me. Is that you? All things are lawful. You can blaspheme the Holy Ghost. Don't worry. All things are lawful. No, that's anomia. When you say all things are lawful, that means lawlessness or anomia. Are you understand me? When someone says all things are lawful, that means there's no wrongdoing, right? A nihilistic position that there's nothing wrong in and of itself. Are you with me? It's nihilism. It is by definition lawlessness, which is the Greek word anomia, which is translated iniquity, which God says Depart from me, you workers of iniquity. I do not know you. Is that plain enough? I want you to have, I preach these things to you tonight, not for knowledge's sake, but so that you can have a defense against the wiles and trickery of Satan. So that you recognize that Satan, right now, and his angels that are with him, are the principalities and powers, they are authorities, spiritual wickedness right now in high places. They purpose to make sure that you do very little, if anything, in the kingdom of God. And their primary purpose is to make sure that they take you out and that you don't make heaven. But need not fear, for you're seated in a heavenly realm. You've been blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly places. Christ Jesus, who's far above all principalities, power, might, dominion, lives on the inside of you. The Holy Ghost, which not all hell can stand against for one second, surrounds you and fills you. You have all divine power and ability. You can tell the devil what he has to do any time of day you want to tell him. Amen. And he's got to obey. Even though he's a rebellious, he has to obey because he has no power to stand. He was destroyed at Calvary's cross. His power was stripped from him. For everyone who stands in the light with Christ Jesus. Amen. Kutana gasitena. Hallelujah. Finally, brethren, be strong in the strength of the Lord and power of his might. People, it's good to walk with God. Why walk with demon spirits? Why miss out on walking in the Holy Ghost over some lust of the flesh, over some interaction with a power of darkness who hates you and hates God? Come on, man. Sin isn't that big and that powerful. Look, righteousness is far bigger. It's so much more wonderful to walk in the ways of God. I mean, what happens is we sell out for cheap, for some cheap thrill that brings pain and torment. When if we would have just stood fast in obedience to God, we would have been able to walk in the high places and enjoy the abundance of all good things. He's given to us every good and perfect thing. Did you know that? Every good and perfect gift. Did you know that? He's called us to glory and virtue. Did you know that? He's given to us his divine power. Did you know that? Do you know his power right now? His divine power, the excellency of his glory is right now like a treasure on the inside of us. Did you know that? Did you know that he's given to us his divine nature, that we have now escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust? Did you know that? Did you know that? It's wonderful, isn't it? To live this life, to say no to Satan, to say no to sin, to say no to the suggestion of demon spirits, not to live in strife and criticism, the pointing the finger and accusation and slander and hatred and bitterness and unforgiveness, but live over here in this love. Ooh, my goodness. And joy and peace and be happy all day long. Amen. Come on, let's walk with the Holy Ghost. As many as are born of God, they walk with the Holy Spirit. Come now, commune in fellowship with angels. Let God show you the beauty of life, immeasurable and unlimited. Hallelujah. Thank you for my son. Every weapon formed against us cannot prosper. Satan lies in wait to deceive. There are assignments that he comes out against us with to try to destroy us. But Father renders every one of them ineffective. He breaks off the yoke. They can only stand for so long. God gives everybody a chance. Everybody, Father, gives everyone an opportunity. Everyone, excludes no one. Please take full advantage of your opportunity. Seize this wonderful gift. Lay hold on eternal life. Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Everybody, would you stand with me? I want you to know that God is on your side, that he will take your part. I want you to know that there's no power that exists that is able to stand against you and succeed against your will and pluck you out of his hands. No power. No power is able to take you out against your will. As long as you're willing, you just say, Father, all I want to live in your kingdom. I want nothing to do with Satan. I want you to be my leader. I don't want nothing to do with the powers of darkness. Oh God, I only want your ways. I tell you, Father, I ask you, take charge of my life. I want only you, and I want only that which belongs to you in my life. Keep that demon away from me. Keep that devil away from me. I want nothing. I know he's trying to claim me. I want nothing to do with him. I guarantee you, Papa God's going to be jealous over you now. Huh? That's the way I talk to the Father in the midst of temptation. Father, you hear him. You hear this lie and deceit trying to cast its desire upon me. I want nothing to do with the prince of darkness and the spirit of disobedience. People, it works for me. It'll work for you. You call upon Father in sincerity and truth. Praise God. Amen. Hallelujah. Ain't no power of darkness going to take you out. No sin can take you out. No, you not have to deal with any kind of sin except for that which is common unto men. Hallelujah. I'm telling you right now, the more you walk with God, the more you walk in the Spirit, the more useful you become, the stronger you become, and the more Satan comes at us and is allowed to come at us with harder and more difficult tactics. But when you can defeat him at that point of weakness that you're in right now, you'll be able to defeat him later. True? When you're not really bringing anybody into the kingdom, you're not really affecting many people's lives, you're not really ministering the gospel with any great authority or impact. You know, I mean, Satan's just interested. He's still interested in destroying you, but, you know, he's just going to take you out with strife and arguing and bickering and dissatisfaction, despair and disgruntledness and discouragement and, you know, some pornography on the internet and some terrible stuff on, you know, this, that place and that place and relationships and whatever. But when he can't do that, that's easy stuff. Two hands for beginners. That's easy stuff. Just say no. You know how hard it is to say, do not sin? Say no. Somebody said, well, how about sins you're not conscious of? Well, don't worry about them right now. Just take care of the ones you're conscious of. Always a big distraction. Don't forget it. Forget about that, Father. Take care of that later. Amen. Jesus Christ loves you with such a passion. He died for you. And I'm confident of this one thing. For everybody who's serious about God, God's serious about you. And he who began a good work in you will finish it. You'd be confident about that too. I'm confident. Are you confident? If you're not confident tonight, God wants to make you confident. I know that there's people that are here tonight, there are people that are watching me by the web or on YouTube right now, that you're not confident. You've been a little bit overwhelmed, wondering, am I even saved? Have I been born again? What this preacher is saying is, whoa, he's just really bringing it down to some serious absolutes. I'm telling you, I understand how that Satan has lied and deceived and used all manner of different influences to compromise your walk with God. I'm telling you tonight, the Word of God is plain and present for everybody to read. Never before has there been so much availability of the Word of God. You got Bible programs on the computer, on the internet, and of every different kind and shape and size. Everybody can get the Greek and the Hebrew at the click of a mouse. Come on. Just read the Word of God. Just read the Word of God. And it will be a strong defense for you. And the Word of God will abide in you, and you will be strong and overcome the wicked one. So be strong in the strength of the Lord, the power of his might, so that you can overcome the wicked one, so that you recognize that those things that Satan is doing in his trickery won't be able to be effective. You'll take him down. He'll come at you and take him down. My goodness, just a half Nelson and a twist. Bang! Out for the count. Are you with me? Huh? Take them down. Take them down in Jesus' name. Take them down with the authority of God. As many as believed, he gave us the power, the authority to be the sons of God. That's it. All we had to do is receive what he gave. We believed what he said. We received what he gave by the Spirit. We gave. Then we're empowered with the authority to be a son of God. And to be a son of God is to be in Christ Jesus, to be seated together with him, to live in him. He lives in us, and he's above all principalities, powers, might, dominion. He is the only man who has completely lived a sinless life. He's the only man who's destroyed and defeated Satan at every point. And we are in him. He's in us. So we're good to go. Amen. Outside of Jesus Christ, Satan could claim us and through that claim defeat us and control us and have all authority over us. But we not outside of Christ. We in Christ. He is our righteousness. Therefore, Satan cannot claim us any more than he can come claim Jesus. Therefore, we're good to go. Therefore, we have all power and all authority. Tread over all the power, Satan. Amen. And nothing can by any means harm us. Can't harm me spiritually. Hallelujah. Can't harm me. Cannot harm me spiritually, Satan. Come on. Get bold. You just walk around thinking, God, I just walk around. That's what I do. That's my worst time. I just walk around thinking, Lord, I thank you that you gave me power. I laugh in the face of the devil. He can't touch me. Can't harm me. Oh, thank you, Lord God, that you've poured out such grace upon my soul. Upon my life. Father, I thank you that you love me so much. You jealous over me. You won't let anybody mess with me. You won't let any weapon formed against me prosper. Come on now, get happy. Get bold. Boldness is a fruit of the Spirit as much as love is. And you're going to have fruits of the Spirit when you walk in humility. What is humility? I'm going to give you a visual. Soft, moldable clay. Holy Ghost make you whatever he wants. Love makes you love. Joy. Huh? Makes you peace, makes you bold, makes you confident, huh? Right? Makes you the image of Christ. Put on, therefore, the Lord Jesus Christ. Put on, therefore, the Lord Jesus Christ, who is far above all principality, power, and might, and every name that is named. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ, who defeated Satan and destroyed the power of the wicked one. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ, who has overcome every work of the enemy and destroyed all the powers of darkness. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh to fulfill its lust. Amen. Amen. No provision. Some of you might need to get rid of your computers. You know, you need to, if you got an iPad, if you bought an iPad, you ought to get rid of it. Then let the Lord buy you one. And it's his, and consecrate it to him for holy purposes and holy use. It's his. And you just pull it down out of heaven, as it were, and say, Father, thank you that I get to use this for your purposes. It's consecrated, sanctified. Same way it goes with a computer. Same way it goes with a smartphone. Huh? Listen, you just got to understand, if you're not strong enough in the faith to go around that stuff that's there, you better be smart enough to get it out of your life before it destroys your soul. Because I tell you, you play around with sin, and sin will take you out. You play around in a pit of vipers, and you're going to ultimately get bit. I don't care how good of a charmer you are, how good of a snake handler you might be. You're going to get bit. You have to get wise. People, you got addictions going on in your life. You got reoccurring sin where Satan believes all he's got to do is just hang out and take you out. Let me just tell you something. Start fasting and praying. It won't be long. Father, see that. Father, look and you go. You see your seriousness. See your heart's passion. It's what Father sees. Somebody said, oh, well, the Lord knows my heart. Yes, he does. He absolutely does. And he's described how it, the manifestations of your heart in his word. And he says you don't get good fruit from an evil tree. And you don't get evil fruit from a good tree. That's what Jesus said. Do you understand that? That's what he said. He said you'll know them by their fruits. That's what Jesus said. And he was talking about the fruits of righteousness versus the fruits of wickedness. He was being very pointed in a description of how people having sin and wrongdoing in their life versus the life of God being made manifest. Come on, let's walk in the light. Come on now. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, I set you free right now. In the name of Jesus, come, resign your heart. Resign your life over to God. Offer your body up as a living sacrifice tonight. Give yourself wholly to Jesus. Let the Spirit of truth come sanctify you. Set you apart. Consecrate yourself afresh to the Lord. Renew your vows to Him. And from this day forward, trust solely in the Lord God. And He will make certain that you succeed. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Praise God. Listen, we want to encourage all of you tonight. We want you to give. In your tithes and your offerings, and honor the Lord with your substance. He's going to honor you. Watch what Father will do as He multiplies those that seed is sown. I mean, I just believe the Lord wants to raise up people with lots of financial blessings and means. It's going to take a couple of things. One, faithfulness in giving, and also faithfulness in doing. God wants to make you faithful on every area, faithful in every area of your life. Just do it. God will bless the works of your hands. Amen. He will not bless the slothfulness of your inactivity. Amen. But He will bless the works of your hands. Amen. Amen. I want to pray before you come. I'm still just pressed in my spirit. I want to pray for you. If you are here tonight, watching on the web, listening by YouTube, and you have not found the power that overcomes sin, I'm going to pray for you right now, and if you'll agree with me, and if you'll pray this prayer with me, you'll discover the overcoming power. John said in 1 John chapter 5, verse 3, he said, "This is the victory, the conquering power that overcomes the world, even our faith." Our faith is that we've been washed in the blood, we've been born of the Spirit, we've been given a new spirit, we've been given a new heart. God's put His Holy Spirit on the inside of us. He's baptized us and filled us with His presence. He's given us this word of life and this word of authority. He's given us the ability to stand against all the powers of darkness. And so tonight, if you just agree with me and just accept what God has done and turn your life completely over to the Lord and begin now to live by what the Word of God says. Begin to live by every word which proceeds out of the mouth of God. It's written down in your Bible. Begin to touch heaven so that heaven can touch you. Be willing to let the Holy Spirit come and fill you. Be willing to have a relationship instead of a religion. And this day will begin a new realm of life for you. This will be the first day of a new beginning. This will be that day that God brought you out of compromise and brought you out of a place where Satan was able to take advantage. All you have to do is call upon the name of the Lord with an honest and sincere heart, with a consecration to say, "I want to serve only you, God. I'm done serving Satan. I'm done living my own life. I want to live your life." And when you get serious with God, He gets serious with you, and everything will change. People say, "Well, I got this ongoing problem." That's not God's fault. That's your insincerity. Just get serious. Father has promised to do a grace work in the life of everybody who calls. And He's not going to fail you because He's no respecter of persons. Everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord. Amen. Amen. He comes and rescues us because He loves us. He loves us so much. So isn't it wonderful to be loved? Have you ever, you know what I'm saying? Have you ever really begun to just walk around pondering, letting God talk to you about how much He loves you? It's a wonderful thing. Just to meditate on, walk around in His presence, letting Him talk to you and show you and reveal to you in a way that only He can do it, how much He loves us. About time He gets done talking to you for just a little while, convincing you of how much He loves you. You're like, Father, I'm never going to hurt you again, disappoint you again. I'm never going to do that. I'm never going to do anything that displeases you, Papa. I want to please you always. I want to be perfect for you. I'll be perfect for you. And I thank you, Lord, that you make my way perfect. You're my provider. You're my protector. You're my perfecter. You gave your life at Calvary so that I might live. You became my righteousness. You became sin so that I might be made the righteousness of God, and I find all my righteousness in you. You sanctified yourself, oh God, that I might find my holiness living my life in your life. What a blessing, eh? Just walk around talking to the Lord like that throughout the day. You won't have too much problem with the devil. You won't. And catch yourself. When you're walking in the anointing, you walk in that joy, that peace, and then you get aggravated or say something or get offended, you better be careful. And you can feel yourself now compromising things in the spirit. People do it all the time. They step over the threshold of what's right with God and begin to participate with a wrong attitude, spirit of offense. They get upset, get mad, and it goes from one thing to the next thing to the next thing. Spirals right out of control. You walk with God, you get very sensitive to disobeying or doing things or participating with things that are not pleasing Him. I'm telling you right now, if I say something that's not pleasing to the Lord, say something that, you know, is like, you know, I said something to a person the other day, just it was true. I said, you know, it was in confidence, and I said something to a person, but it wrought in some ways a bit of despairing, you know, brought a little bit of a shadow upon the person that I was referring to. Man, I can't go sleep at night. I can get that stuff right. Just get sensitive with the Holy Ghost. Let Him be sensitive. And He's so wonderful because when we're serious, He just cleanses us. Just cleanses, washes us. He don't say, well, that's all right. He just says, I forgive you. He don't say, oh, it's okay. You don't wink as, oh, that's okay. It wasn't okay. It's wrong. Mama, I'll wash you up and cleanse you. I'll make you holier than the angels. Amen. I'll make you as pure as I am. Can you imagine that? Oh, God, He's so good. Would you receive that right now? I'm asking you right now by the Spirit of the Lord, will you receive a cleansing? Right now, God wants to cleanse you, wants to wash you. Will you receive a cleansing? All you have to do is believe. All you have to do is believe and have faith in the blood of Jesus Christ, and the blood of Jesus Christ will cleanse you from all unrighteousness. I said the blood of Jesus Christ will cleanse you from all unrighteousness. You confess your sins, He's faithful and just to forgive you and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. I said you confess your sins, He's faithful and just to forgive you and cleanse you from all unrighteousness. I want those things to become affectionate and real to our hearts, dear people, which only the Holy Ghost can make them real to our hearts as we get serious with Him. You know, Christ Jesus became our Lamb. You know, and I can go back as a person who loves my animals, a person who's just born to be a farmer, rancher, guy and a guy. My little lamb, you know, the perfect little lamb. Lambs are the cutest little things anyways when they're born. Think puppy dogs are cute. You ought to see a little lamb. And then it's the lamb, it's a prized lamb, it's perfect. It's your pet. It's the one you love. They're so affectionate, so sweet, so gentle, so tender. And now you're going to come and bring it to the altar. In the Old Testament, they'd come, bring it to the altar. They would lay their hands on it. It had to be an offering near to the heart for it to be right. They'd lay their hands on it. And they would confess their sins, thus transferring their sins into this innocent victim. And then holding the lamb, the priest would cut its throat and the blood would go squirting everywhere. And most of it would be caught in the basin. Some of it would be on the priest, some of it would be on the altar. That's where I stand with Jesus, though, you see. When I sin, I come to him. I don't come like some just wink it at, and just some, oh, well, you know, we're going to all do it more or less every day, and it doesn't really offend God. It's not really that bad. Satan plays his trick. Oh, yeah, you can do it and just repent later. The Lord wants to make himself more real to you than that. Mm-hmm. He wants to make this more real to you than that. And if you just walk with him, if you just ask him, if you just get real with him, he will. He'll open your eyes. He'll cause you to see. And then when you come to him, you say, Lord Jesus, I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. I don't know how I did that. God, I'm sorry. I promise you, Father God, by your help and your grace, I'll never do that again. I'm sorry, Father God, that I tripped into that, that I allowed myself to be overwhelmed by that thing. Lord Jesus, I know you paid such a high price for me not to sin. But I thank you so much that your blood right now is still available for me to wash me. And I take your blood, oh God. I take that blood that poured out of your body where you, when you were there on the cross, that blood that was at a great expense of suffering and pain and sorrow to you. To wash my sin right now that I've committed and transgressed against you, Lord. I'm telling you right now, you get serious about God like this, and that stuff will come to an end in your life. That nonsense and demonic association will come to an end. That playing games with God, that walking around in the pride of life. I see more people in the church walking around with a pride of life, opens them up to a spirit of offense, constantly being tossed to and fro. In Jesus' name, I command this power of darkness to leave you alone. But I recognize that I can only do so much just now, because each man has his own will. When sometimes we say this and we hear Satan say, I don't have to leave him alone. He wants me. He enjoys, or she enjoys, my fellowship. They like the spirit of offense. They like feeling boastful about themselves. They like to feel superior. They like to make themselves right. They're not used to being wrong. You need to, as a child of God, you need to get used to being wrong. You need to get yourself broken and to say, I'm wrong, and God is right, and I'm going to be moldable. Amen. Amen. Don't let Satan persecute you anymore, okay? Don't let Satan lie to you anymore. Don't let him trick you with his deceits. Come walk in the Spirit. Walk in this love and walk in this life. From this day forward. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. We'll find a bunch of people around you. Hug them. Tell them that you love them. Anybody, if you want prayer for anything, I'm going to pray for you. I want to pray for you. Also, I want you to listen to me. I don't want you to get carried away too loudly yet. I want you to come worship the Lord with your giving. I want to also remind everybody, listen to me. We've got another door-to-door outreach coming this Saturday. The fruit of the last outreach was great. It was wonderful. What God did with that sacrifice. I know it's out of some of your comfort zone. Now you can have a little bit more respect for the Mormons and the Jehovah's Witness, who are really, really willing to pay the price for what they believe. Because it's not like that they got it, you know. They got it any easier. But we have life-giving power. And if you go beyond the threats of Satan and recognize that wherever the soles of your feet tread, God will give you the possession of that land. And that when you speak the word of life, it doesn't matter how much a person slams the door, they're impacted by it. And just lay down your life. I want you to give your life. Let 2014 be a testimony to you throughout all the ages to come that that was the year that you held nothing back. You gave a tithe of your day, every day, 2.4 hours to the Lord, every day, tithe of your time, to see the lost reached, the kingdom of God manifested, name of Jesus glorified, the word of God preached. Amen. Amen. Anything else? Pastor Kelly? And everybody's going to be here at 10:45. 11 to 1. 11 to 1. 11 to 1. So 2 hours. Was it 2 hours last week? 2 hours, 755 houses, 264 people home, 42 interested people, 6 salvations without hardly trying. That's just warming up. You know, laying hold of those statistics are really good. I love that. And that was in the hard ground. Now, you guys didn't go over to the soft ground yet, did you?
Not thoroughly.
You guys haven't crossed the bridge. But it ain't going to be long. You're warming up over here, and then you go and advance over into Hindus and Muslims and amen. All those hungry people that are hungry for Jesus, and they could just see the life of God being manifested in us. They're going to come. They're going to come. Amen. Once again, come worship the Lord with the offering. Find people that you don't know. Don't hug people that you do know to start with. Wait till later for them. Find people that you don't know. Introduce yourself to them. Okay? If you want me to pray for you, I will. I'm happy to pray with anybody for anything, spiritually, physically, financially. Doesn't matter what it is. I know the Lord Jesus to touch you.